For the past few lectures, we've been exploring the topic of data abstraction and their role in modularizing complex systems, and in particular, the relationship between data structures and the procedures that manipulate them. Today, we're going to add a new aspect to that topic by looking at the issue of mutation, that is, how to change or alter a data structure rather than simply copying it. We're going to look at two examples of useful and interesting data structures, and in particular, show how, while mutation carries some cost with it, it also supports very efficient implementations of such data structures. To set the stage for what we're going to do today, let's review what we know about data abstractions. First of all, an abstraction comes with a constructor, that is, a way of gluing pieces together into a data object. And remember that in what we saw a few lectures ago, we should probably also attach a type tag to the object as part of this constructor. Associated with the constructor are a set of selectors or accessors that get pieces back out. And these are governed by a contract that talks about the relationship between the constructor, which glues things together, and the selectors that unglue those pieces and pull out parts of the data structure. And finally, we saw that there would be a set of operations that use the data objects, without worrying about the details of the implementation. The form is to use the selectors to get out the pieces, do some work to assemble the parts of a new version of the object, and then use the constructor to build up a new object out of the pieces we've just built. The new thing we are adding is a mutator. This is a method that will change an existing data structure, that is, go in and actually alter something in the structure, as opposed to creating a new version of the object. And that's what we're going to turn to in what follows. Let's start by looking at very simple data structures. For example, we know that we can bind a variable or a name to a value. This is not a complex data abstraction, but it has some of the same properties. Here, we know that the special form define binds the name or symbol given by the first argument to the value of the second expression. To get back the value associated with the variable, we just use the name itself. That is, when we evaluate the name, it looks up the value bound to it by the define expression and returns that value. In other words, it pulls apart the binding of name and value and returns one component of. Now we've introduced the ability to mutate that variable, to change the binding associated with it. Let's look first at the expression that does that. It's shown here, open paren set bang x double quote foo close double quote close paren. This is again a special form, and it operates as follows. It takes the first argument, x, treats it as a name. It takes the second argument, evaluates it using the normal rules of evaluation, and then it is going to change the binding associated with x. Note, this looks a lot like a define, but is not. Define would simply create a binding for x. Setbang looks for the binding associated with x and actually changes it, thereby causing the first value to be lost. Over the next few lectures, we'll see why setbang is actually different than define. But the key thing for now is that setbang has to find a binding for a previously defined variable, in this case x, and changes its value. So what does adding mutation do to our system? Well, several things. The first is that we've now broken the substitution model. It's okay, we're going to replace it with a better model next time around. And in fact, the substitution model really assumed that we were dealing with functional programming with no mutation or side effects. And what does that mean? Functional programming means that we can conceptually treat our procedures as if they're mathematical functions. I know, some dealt with symbolic data, but the idea of a function still holds. And this means that a procedure was a mapping from input values to output values. More importantly, that mapping was consistent no matter when we did the evaluation. So in the example shown here, if I define x to have the value 10, and then I evaluate the expression plus x5, of course I get 15. If I do a whole bunch of other intervening operations and come back and again evaluate plus x5, I will still get 15. The expression has the same value every time it's evaluated. It's the same scope as its binding, and nothing has changed. This means that this expression has a value no matter when in time it occurs, and it really behaves like a mapping from input values to output values. Once we've introduced mutation or assignment into our language, this no longer holds. In particular, an expression's value now depends on when we evaluate it. In fact, notice what term I used. We've introduced time into our system in a very fundamental way. Now an expression's value depends on the context surrounding it, that is, what other expressions have been evaluated before it, and identical expressions from a syntactic viewpoint may now have very different semantics, because that semantics now depends on the context. To see this, look at the example. Again, we define x to have the value 10. If we evaluate the expression plus x5, we of course get 15, because x was just defined to have the value 10. Now, sometime later, we evaluate setbang x to 94. Remember, this goes in and finds the binding or pairing of x in our environment and changes it to have the value 94. If, sometime after that, we again evaluate plus x5, what's the value for x? Well, it's now 94, and in fact, the value of this whole expression is now 99. Notice, two exactly the identical expressions, plus x5, now give rise to different values, even though functionally they appear identical. time now matters in our system because we have the ability to mutate the expressions and their values. As we'll see shortly, this has some advantages for us, although it also increases some potential dangers in terms of how we set up our programs. Okay, not only can we mutate simple objects, we can also mutate other basic data structures. For pairs of lists, we also have mutators that change the pieces. Let's look at this. Just to remind you, we of course have a constructor, const, that glues two things together to create a pair. We have two selectors or accessors, car and coulda, that get out the right pieces of that pair. And now we have two mutators, setCarBang and setCouldaBang. And look carefully at what they do. Each of them is a normal procedure. It takes in two expressions. It evaluates the first argument to get a pointer to a pair, in this case, the value of p. It then evaluates the second expression to get a new value or structure. Its operation, in the case of setCarBang, is to take the car part of the pair p, or rather the pair pointed to by p, and change it to point to the value of new x. Similarly, setCouldaBang takes the coulda part of the pair pointed to by p and changes that to point to the new value, that value given by the value of new y. Note the type definition associated here. It takes in a pair and something of any type, and what it returns is undefined because it's being used strictly for the side effect, for the fact that it's going to go in and change the structure associated with the pair. As we'll see shortly, having the ability to mutate structures certainly buys us some power in terms of our computational engine, but it also raises some interesting problems, and we want to highlight those first. For example, suppose I create a list of the elements 1 and 2 with that first define statement, and I also give the same structure the name b. That is, defining b to have the value of a will create the structure shown at the right, with both a and b pointing to the same list structure. And remember, the second define does not create a copy of the list. It simply returns the value of a, which is the pointer to that list structure. If I ask for the value of a, I get out the list 1, 2. And if I ask for the value of b, I also get out the list 1, 2, as you'd expect. Now, suppose somewhere else in my code, I evaluate the expression shown in red, setCarBang of a to 10. What does this do? We get the value of a, that's the pointer to the list structure up in the right. We then get the value of 10, which is 10. And we change the car pointer of A to point to the value 10. We literally break that first pointer and replace it with a second pointer, now pointing to the value 10, as shown. So what? Well, now notice that the value of B has changed. If I ask for the value of B, it points to that list structure and it returns the list 10 and 2. And yet nowhere in my code do I have anything that says I've changed B. In this simple example, we know what's happening, but you can see that there's a potential now for lots of bugs. Because I can go in and mutate parts of list structure, I may have the potential for confusing what I'm storing in some place and having values no longer refer to the things I thought they did. So now I have two simple kinds of mutators, setBang to change bindings of variables, and setCarBang and setCouldaBang that change the structures associated with pairs, and obviously therefore with any kind of list structure. In order to use these mutators, we both want to know what happens if we mutate a particular structure, and, equally importantly, what kind of mutation do I need to do in order to cause a desired change in a list structure? For example, suppose I define the following little list structure. I'll define x to be the list of the symbol a and the symbol b. Now let's suppose I want to change that structure to have the form shown here. What do I have to do? What expression do I have to evaluate in order to cause this to happen? When you're ready to answer, hit the mouse to go on to the next part of the slide. Well, here it is, and we can reason this through. First, we know what we want to change. We want to change the car part of the second part of that list. So we're going to need to evaluate coulda of x to get to the second part of the list. That'll give us the blue part of this structure. Once we have that, we can do a setCar on that to change the car part of that pointer. And what should that point to? Well, the list 1, 2, which is the box and structure pointer shown in red, and we get that by literally evaluating list of 1, 2. So notice how we can use an expression to get a particular part of a box and pointer structure and then mutate either the car or coulda part of that thing to give it a new value. So it might occur to you to ask, do we have a problem? And what do I mean by that? Well, given that different parts of a structure can now change, in particular we can go in and mutate any part of a list structure, how do we tell if two things are equivalent? We already saw in our example a few slides ago that we could have two different names for the same structure, and in that case, mutating part of one structure would cause the value associated with the other name to change. Well, mutation causes us to ask the question of what does it mean for things to be equivalent? And in fact, as it suggests here, to decide that really means we have to be careful about the definition of equivalent. If we want to know if two things are exactly the same object, we have a special test called EQ? EQ? Returns true if the two expressions literally point to exactly the same structure. Another way of saying that is, these two things will be equivalent if making any change to one structure causes a corresponding change to the other apparent structure. So EQ, in some sense, is the finest level of testing of equality. On the other hand, if we simply want to know whether two objects look the same, that is, will they print out with the same kind of list structure, then we'll test that with equal? In the example shown, equal of the list 1,2 and the list 1,2 will return true. They print to the same kind of list structure. But of course, we know that these two evaluations of list will generate different versions of the list because they are built out of consists. And in that case, testing with EQ? Will return false. These do not point to exactly the same structure inside of the machine. So we have two different ways of telling if things are equivalent, two different levels of granularity. This idea of mutation and testing of equality raises some interesting issues now. In particular, if we mutate an object, do we still have the same object? And the answer is yes if we retain the same pointer to the object. Another way of saying that is, if we have some list structure, and we have a pointer to the beginning of that list structure, we then go in and mutate some part of that list structure, but keep a hold of that pointer to the beginning of the structure, then in fact we still have the same object. Its value has changed, but it is still the same object. This tells us how to keep track of a particular object, how to know we have the same object. Related to that is the question of deciding when two objects actually are shared between one another. Or said slightly better, how do we tell if parts of a data structure are actually shared across different data structures as opposed to being distinct? And the answer is, if we mutate one and see that the other also changes, then we know they're shared. This again comes back to that notion of equality. At the finest level, if it points to the same structure, any change I make to that structure will be seen by the name that points to it from the other side. So what we see then is that introducing mutation into our language has caused us to change how we think about equality, how we think about the finest level of detail in our system. And that's going to raise interesting questions about identity. What does it mean for two objects to be the same? What does it mean for two objects simply to be equivalent? And what does it mean for objects to share actual structure? Okay, let's see if you're catching on to this. Here are two definitions for X and Y. I've created them. They're two different list structures as shown. And I want to now evaluate setCar of X to Y and then see what the value of X is. And after doing that, I want to evaluate setCoulder of Y to be Coulder of X, and I want to see what the value of X is after that. Take a second to think about this. When you're ready, click the mouse button, and we'll see if you've got this. Okay, let's evaluate setCarBang of X, Y. First, we evaluate X. We get the pointer to that top-level list structure, as shown. We also evaluate Y. That's also a pointer to a list structure. And then what do? We take the box and pointer structure for X, we take the car pointer of the first pair of X, and change it. We break the old pointer and insert a new pointer pointing to the value of Y. If we now ask for the value of X, we can see it's a list 2 elements long. The first element happens to be the list 1,2, and the second element is simply the number 4, giving us the structure shown. Now remember that time is important once we have mutation. We've already changed X to have a particular structure. If we evaluate setCoulder of Y to be Coulder of X, notice what happens. We get the value of Y. That's a pointer to that list structure shown at the bottom. We then are going to change the Coulder pointer of that first pair. We break the old pointer, and the new value we have is going to point to the Coulder of X. X is a pointer to the top level structure. We get the Coulder of that, and we insert the new arrow as shown. If we now go back and ask for the value of X, it's changed. It's still a list 2 elements long, but notice what happens here. The first element is a list also 2 elements long, that is the list 1 and 4, no longer the list 1, 2. So we've had the ability now to change parts of this structure with some sharing going on. So to summarize, here are the key things we've seen. We have in Scheme some built-in mutators, ways of changing built-in data abstractions, namely variables and pairs, one of which, setBang, is set up to change the variable or a binding, the other two of which, setCarBang, setCoulderBang, are set up to change the associated parts of a pair. And secondly, we've seen that mutation introduces some substantial complexity into our language. It can lead to unexpected side effects, and it has broken our substitution model, which is no longer sufficient. We now have time inextricably intertwined into our evaluations, and that's changed the aspect of programming. No longer are things simply functional, they actually have to take into account context. These sound like negatives, but what we're going to see in the rest of the lecture is how mutation also buys power for us. Now, what we're going to do is see how mutation can affect our means of building abstractions. And so we're going to first build a new abstraction, actually a very useful one, without mutation, and then see how adding mutation changes the behavior. The abstraction we're going to build is called a stack. And this is something you've actually seen before. This data abstraction behaves just like a stack of dishes in a cafeteria. That is, you can push something onto the top of the stack, you can take things off of the top of the stack, but those are the only operations that can affect it. This is also referred to as a last-in, first-out data structure, since the last thing you put into the structure is the first thing you take out of it. So here's a filled-out version of the template that we want. We have a constructor, we'll call it makeStack, just returns an empty stack. We'll have a set of selectors, we'll have in particular a single selector called top that returns the current top element of the stack. That's the only thing we can take out of it. And we'll have some operations on a stack. We'll have the ability to insert a new element onto the top of the stack. We'll have the ability to return a new stack with the top element removed or deleted, and we'll have a way of testing whether a stack is empty or not. So notice, the selector top gets us the top element of the stack. It's the only thing that gets us something directly from the stack. The operations insert and delete either push a new element onto the stack or remove an element from the stack. And of course, empty stack, as we said, is just our way of telling whether there's anything in the stack. To really be careful, we should define what the contract is for a stack, and in particular, what the associated behaviors are between the constructor, the selector, and the operations that manipulate a stack. And here's a rather formal definition, although if you work it through, you'll see it makes sense. To set up the contract, let's let S be the name for a stack that was created by our constructor, and let's assume that all of the subsequent stack operations have been applied, where I is the number of insertions that we've made, and J is the number of deletions we've made from the stack. Then, the stack contract has the following behavior. If we've made more deletions than insertions, we have an error. Makes sense. If we've made exactly the same number of insertions and deletions, then empty stack will return true. And more importantly, if we try and get something off the top of the stack or delete something from the stack, we'll get an error. There's nothing there. If we've made fewer deletions than insertions, there should be things still left on the stack. And in that case, the empty stack is false. More importantly, the behavior of the stack is that if we were to insert, then delete something from the stack, and look at the top of the stack, it'll be the same as if we had not done either of those insert or delete operations. In other words, nothing below the stack has changed. And finally, if we have made no more deletions than we have insertions into the stack, then if we insert something onto the stack and look at the top, we'll get exactly that value out for anything that we push onto the stack. So we see that this contract specifies what we expected. We can only push things onto the stack, pop them off the top, and if we do that, the last thing in will be the first thing out. Okay, we've been proceeding as we normally would in building up a data abstraction. We've defined the behavior on it, we've defined the contract, we specified what kinds of operations we want to have. Now we can go ahead and implement. And our first strategy will be a simple one. Let's just implement a stack as if it was a list. So for example, this list structure might represent a stack. The first element, A, will be the last thing we pushed onto the stack. B would have been the thing pushed prior to A, and D would have been the first thing pushed onto the stack. Our strategy then will simply be to insert and delete items off the stack by inserting and deleting things from the front of this list. And of course, completing the implementation should be something you're now getting somewhat familiar with. MakeStack will be a procedure of no arguments that simply returns an empty list. EmptyStack, well, we'll just use null to see if it's an empty list or not. We're building on top of that earlier data abstraction. Insert will simply const a new element onto the front of a stack. Since the stack's represented as a list under the property of closure, consting a new element onto it will give us a new list back out. And of course, we know what we have to do with the contract. Delete needs to make sure that we take the right thing off of the stack. Here, it'll check to see if we have an empty stack. If we do, we're in trouble, we complain. Otherwise, we take the cutter of the stack. That is, remove the first element and just return the rest of the stack. And of course, top, similarly, will check to see, is there an empty stack here, in which case complain. Otherwise, give us the value of the first element, the thing at the top of the stack, which is sitting in the car. So notice how we've built on top of the list abstraction to build our stack. We've gotten the right kind of behavior, and you can convince yourself by just checking to see that the details of the contract hold for this particular implementation. So far, this looks fine. We've just built a new-to-data abstraction called a stack. We built it on top of lists, and it seems like we're all set. But notice in this particular form of implementation, our stacks do not have an identity. And that's a real problem. For example, let's give the name S to a new stack, an empty stack. And if we evaluate S, we get back this empty list. Now, let's insert the element A into S. That, in fact, returns a list with a single element A into it. But if I ask for the value of S, I get back the empty list, because I haven't actually changed what S is pointing to. I changed the list structure, I added something to it, but I didn't return the pointer to the beginning of that structure. That's clearly a problem. I don't have an identity associated with the stack. Worse yet, I can mutate parts of the stack. If I insert B into S, I ought to, in principle, have the stack of B and A, but I can go ahead and change what S is pointing to point to the value returned by this. And now I get back just the list B. So we have a problem here. We haven't isolated out the stack from the operations that can manipulate it. We'd really like our data abstraction to only be accessible to the contract operations and not to anything else. So let's see how we're going to fix that in the next chunk. So we know how to do the things we need here to make a better implementation of a stack. The first thing is we need to use defensive programming. Obviously, we should put a tag on front of this stack, add a type to it, so we know what kind of beast we're dealing with. One of the advantages of this is it will provide an object whose identity remains even as the object mutates. What do we mean by that? Well, notice if we put a tag on the front of the object, doing it the standard way, then our stack S would look like the structure shown. It will be a list whose first element is a tag type, saying it's a stack, and whose cutter points to the actual structure itself, in this case the list that is the elements of the stack. For example, now when I do a delete operation on the stack, the behavior I want is for the stack to get out the actual component other than the tag, that is the cutter part of what S points to, change it, mutate it to actually point to everything but the first element of the stack, as shown, and still leave the tag on the front. In this case, S still points to the tag structure. All I've done is change the pieces inside, and that'll fix the problems I saw previously. Notice, however, we're making a fundamental change to the abstraction. We really should make sure that the user is aware of the fact that the object is mutating so that they can deal with the abstraction correctly. And what we've proposed to do here is exactly that. We're going to change our stack to mutate the actual stack pointers, keeping the tag out front. So let's see what we need to do to change our implementation to add this new, more powerful behavior. First of all, our constructor makeStack glues together the tag stack onto an empty list. But be careful here. This really says I'm gluing together two things, a type tag and a structure that represents the stack itself. Having done that, I can introduce a predicate to tell me whether I'm looking at a stack or just some list that is hanging around. How do I do that? Well, stack question mark will check to make sure that the thing passed in is in fact a pair so that I can safely go ahead and get the car of that and check to see that it is the tag or symbol stack. So I have a way of telling whether something is a stack before I apply any operations to it. In our previous version, empty stack just relied on using null to say it's an empty list. But now we can check to make sure that in fact it is a stack object, that is, use our predicate stack, and then, having been certain that we're looking at a stack, go in and see if the cutter of the stack, that is the actual implementation itself, removing the type tag, to see whether that's empty or not. So now we have a much more careful way of telling whether we have an empty stack. Our operations on stacks are now going to be mutators, and I'm going to follow the convention of adding an exclamation point or a bang at the end to indicate that I'm doing that. Look at insert to see what it does. First, it uses defensive programming to make sure that we're actually manipulating a stack, that it's labeled with the appropriate type. Assuming it is, notice how I'm going to do the right addition onto a stack. First, I take the cutter of the argument passed in. That removes the type tag and gives me a pointer to the actual stack itself. I then const a new element onto the front of that. That gives me back a new list with that element at the beginning. And now I go into the stack and mutate or change the cutter pointer, the thing that points to the actual stack contents itself, to point to that new list. And then finally, because I cannot rely on what setCutter returns, I return stack as the value of the whole insert. The key is to notice what I've done here. I still have identity associated with the stack because I have gone in and changed parts of it without changing the overall top pointer. And secondly, I've used defensive programming to ensure that I'm actually manipulating a stack. And thirdly, I've used mutation to change the actual contents of the stack part itself. Having seen insert, you should be able to now look at delete and convince yourself that it does the right thing. And what's the right thing here? Well, basically, it's to take everything but the type tag, that is the cutter of the element, which is pointing to the contents of the stack, and change that to point to everything but the first element of the stack. Draw yourself a little box and pointer diagram to convince yourself this does the right thing. And as before, we'll return the value of stack to give us back the overall structure. And finally, to get the top element of the stack, well, we just make sure that we actually have a stack there. And if we do, we take the cutter to get the actual contents of the stack, not the type tag, and then take the car of that to return the value of the first element. So now we have things that work properly. We've got defensive programming to preserve the types of things. We have preservation of identity of the stacks. And we can, moreover, not go in and do mutations indirectly on them, only through the operations of the stacks themselves. So here we see how mutation gives us additional power. It gives us the ability to change parts of a structure without using up much in the way of space, and yet preserve the identity of the overall structure. Okay, we've seen how mutation can give us different ways of building data abstractions. Now let's really look at how much it helps us by looking at a slightly more complex data abstraction, and that's the abstraction of a queue. A queue behaves like a line, say the line in front of a movie theater. That is, you add things to the end of the queue, you take things off the front of the queue. And as a consequence, it has a different behavior than a stack. While a stack was a last-in, first-out data structure, a queue is a first-in, first-out data structure. That is, the first element into the data structure will be the first element out of it. As with all the other data abstractions, we've got a set of operations on it. We've got a constructor, we'll call it make queue. We'll have an accessor that gets us the front element of the queue. We'll have some mutators that actually change the structures, and because they're mutators, we know they're going to mutate the internal components of this data abstraction. We'll have something that inserts a new element into the queue and returns that new queue with the element at the rear of the queue. And we'll have an operation or a mutator called delete queue that returns a new queue with the element at the front of the queue removed. And finally, we'll have an operation called empty queue that just tests whether the queue is empty or not. And as with stacks, we'll have a contract for it. Here, let's let queue be a queue created by the constructor, and let's let the number of queue procedures that follow be denoted by I as the number of insertions and J as the number of deletions. And furthermore, let X sub I denote the ith item inserted into the queue. With that notation, we can then define the contract that should be associated with the queue. First, if we've tried to delete more items than we have inserted, we should get an error, obviously. Second, if we've deleted exactly as many items as we have inserted, then we should have an empty queue, and moreover, trying to get the first element of the queue or to remove an element from the queue should cause an error. And then the last condition should say, if we have inserted more items than we have deleted, then the first element of the queue should be the one that we'd expect to see, the one just prior to the next deletion. Just as we saw with stacks, let's start with a simple implementation of a queue. And in particular, let's simply represent a queue by a list of elements. Here we'll decide arbitrarily that the order is such that the first element of the list is also the first element of the queue. So getting the first element of the queue is easy. We'll just take the car. Similarly, deleting an element from the queue will simply remove that element, that is, take the cutter. But notice now that insertion is going to be more difficult. To insert an element into the queue, we need to put it at the end. And if we're representing things as a list, we're going to need to copy the existing queue onto the front of the new element. That is, we're going to need to literally make a copy of that entire list and add it to the beginning of a new list that has the new element as that first element. So there's our strategy. We'll represent a queue as a list. First element of the queue is at the first element of the list. And with that in mind, let's see how we build an implementation. Okay, here's the code. And again, it should look fairly straightforward to you. Our constructor just makes an empty list, since we're using lists to represent queues. Testing to see if we have an empty queue. As before, we'll just use null to see if we have an empty list. To find the front of the queue, well, let's make sure we've got a queue so we don't have an error. And if we do, we simply take the value of the first element in the list. Deletion from the queue, that's easy. As long as we've got a queue here, we simply remove the first element and return the remainder of the list using cutter. Inserting an element into the queue, though, is a bit more of a pain. Remember, it's got to go at the end of the queue. So to insert an element into a queue, we use the following little structure. If we have an empty queue, then it's easy. We just build a queue one element long, consing element, ELT, onto an empty queue, or in this case, the empty list nil. Otherwise, we're going to have to make a copy of what we have. So we're going to const the first element of the queue onto whatever we get by inserting the element into the remainder of the queue. And of course, recursively, this is going to walk its way down the queue until we find the end of the queue and then glue the new element on. You can see that this will satisfy the structure or the contract for a queue. Insertion is going to put something at the end of the data abstraction, but you can also see it's going to come with a cost. So in fact, let's look at that cost. How efficient is this simple implementation of a queue? Well, for a queue of length n, let's figure out what time is required to do operations on that queue. And in particular, here we're going to count the number of const, car, and cutter evaluations that we have to execute. And let's look at the space required. That is, how many new const cells are needed when we execute operations on this queue. Let's start with the easy ones. Finding the front element of a queue. Well, it takes time that's simply constant. That is, it's a single operation to get there. Same thing with delete queue. We're just going to take the cutter of the queue in this case rather than the car. It's a single operation in terms of time. That's nice. And in terms of space, Similarly, it's constant. We don't have any new const cells here that we have to generate. We're either getting the car could or out of a list structure. So this is nice and efficient. But as we've already hinted, insert queue is a bit more of a problem. First of all, what's the time associated with inserting a new element into a queue of length n? Well, as we saw from the structure of the procedure, it has to walk its way down the length of the queue to find the end and then insert a new element. So it's going to be linear in terms of the number of operations required. And in terms of space, that is, how many new const cells does it chew up? Well, similarly, it walks its way not only down the queue, but it makes a copy as it goes along, consting up a new version of it. And therefore, it's also linear in the amount of space required. And of course, the obvious question is, can we do better? So let's go back and look at queues again, now seeing how mutation can allow us to build a much more efficient implementation. As before, we'll still have a constructor that returns an empty queue, and an accessor that gets us the front element of the queue. The big change we're going to make is how we actually put things into and out of the queue, in particular inserting and deleting elements from the queue. Here, let's do the following. Rather than making a copy of the queue and adding a new element at the end or the rear of that queue, we're going to go in and actually mutate or modify the structure to directly insert the element at the end. So here we're going to take mutation directly on the structure. Similarly, when we remove an element from the front of the queue, we're going to mutate that structure, not make copies of it. And here's the strategy we'll use. As before, we'll attach a type tag at the front as a defensive measure so we can identify what kinds of structures we have and to give us a way of maintaining identity of the structure. Secondly, we'll build a structure that holds a list of items in the queue plus two things, a pointer to the front of the queue and a pointer to the rear of the queue. Now, we have many ways in which we could do that, but the easiest one is the one shown in the structure. That is, our queue will be a list whose first element is the type tag queue, and whose second element is a pointer to a const pair that has a pointer to the front and rear of the queue. That is, it literally has a pointer to the first pair in the list that represents the queue, and a pointer to the last pair in the list that represents the queue. The underlying representation is still a list, but now notice we're going to have direct access to the beginning and end of the queue, and that's going to help us make much more efficient operations on top of queues. Given that idea, we can create some procedures that are going to manipulate the parts of a queue. And as the slide says, these should really be hidden inside the abstraction. They should be hidden away from the user and only available to things that directly manipulate the queue. First of all, to get the front pointer of the queue, well, we'll take the coulder to strip off the type tag, and then we'll take the car of that pair to get us the pointer to the front. If you go back to the previous slide, you'll see that gives us exactly the right thing. Rear pointer, similarly, will take coulder of the thing to strip off the type tag, and then take coulder of that new element to get the pointer to the rear of the queue. Both of these structures will return us pointers to pairs in the list that actually represents the queue. And then given that we have a thing that gives us the front pointer and the rear pointer of the queue, we want to be able to change them. So we'll have two mutators. To change the front pointer to point to a new element, we'll do the following. We'll take the coulder of the queue, that gives us the actual pair that contains both pointers, and we'll change the car part of that, which is where the front pointer is, to point to a new item. And similarly, for changing the rear pointer, we'll take coulder of the queue to strip off the type tag and give us the pair that points to the two parts of the queue, and we'll change the coulder point of that, which is the rear pointer, to point to some new thing. Now, using those ideas, we can build a much better queue implementation. First of all, our constructor has a slightly unusual form. Look at it carefully. We first const together two empty lists. These are the two empty pointers for the front and rear of the queue because we have nothing initially in the queue, so there's an empty list there. And then on top of that, we const on the tag queue. Draw yourself a little box and pointer diagram to see that this generates the structure you'd expect. Of course, with this defensive programming in place, we can also now have a predicate that tells whether we're actually looking at a queue by making sure it's a pair and then checking to see that the tag is the symbol queue. To see if we have an empty queue, we can be very clever now. We can first check to make sure that there is an actual queue there. Notice how we're using defensive programming to isolate ourselves out from unexpected side effects. Presuming that, in fact, we are looking at a structure labeled to be a queue, then we take the front pointer of the queue and check to see if it's empty. If it is, there's nothing in the queue, therefore it's an empty queue. So far, we're just using defensive programming, and the next element looks much the same. Front of the queue, again, we'll check to see if we actually have a structure there, and presuming we do, we take the front pointer to get the pointer to the beginning of the list that represents the actual elements, and then take the car of that to get the first element in the queue itself. The tricky parts come in actually manipulating the queue, where we want to mutate the structure that represents the actual elements of the queue. First, let's look at insert. To insert a new element into the queue, we need to do the following. We'll first create a list with just the element in it. This will be the end of the new queue once we've put it together. We'll give it a name just temporarily. Let's call it new pair. Now, if there's nothing in the queue, then this structure represents actually the queue I want to have. So I simply go in and change the front and rear pointers to point to this list, a list now one element long. And then I'll return the value of queue as the value of the overall structure. If, however, there is already something in the queue, then I need to do the following. First, I'm going to get the rear pointer to the queue. Remember, this will be a pointer to the last pair in the current element of the queue. And then what do? I mutate the coder of that pair to point to the new pair. Think carefully about what this does. This now creates a new list, but in fact it does it by mutating the end of the list to point to this new list structure, the new element that I added in. You should convince yourself that this still leaves a list in place, but also that notice it's going to do it in much more efficient time than we did before. Of course, I have to preserve the overall structure of the queue. I've added a new element to the list, but now my rear pointer is out of date. So I change the rear pointer to point to this new pair. Again, you ought to draw a little box and pointer diagram to convince yourself that this has set up things in the right format. And deleting an element from the queue has a similar behavior. First of all, if it's an empty queue, of course, we're going to complain. Otherwise, notice what we need to do. We first get the front pointer to the queue. That's going to point to the beginning of the list. We take the coder of that, which removes the first element from the list and gives us a pointer to the rest of the list representing the elements of the queue. And then we change the front pointer of the overall queue to point to that structure. Again, if you're not certain, draw a little box and pointer diagram and run an operation to see that this leaves everything in the right form. So, what are the orders of growth now? Well, you should be able to reason things through and realize that in this case, the two expensive operations, insert and delete, are now both constant in terms of time and space. And as a consequence, mutation has given us a much more efficient way of building abstract data abstractions. So you've seen that we can add mutation to our data abstractions. Mutations are things that operate by side effects. They go in and change the actual values of data structures rather than simply creating new versions of them. And in particular, we saw three kinds: setBang, which changes the values associated with variables, and setCarBang and setCoderBang that change portions of a pair, and therefore any other list structure. We can use that idea to actually extend our notion of a data abstraction to include mutators as part of it, and we can see, as a consequence, that we gain some real power. We get much more efficient data structures by having the ability to mutate them, but we can also cause some interesting problems doing this. And in particular, by introducing mutation into our language, we've added a notion of time to our language. Things are no longer functional in terms of programming style. Substitution model no longer works, and we're going to have to come back and fix that.